Hello, today we're going to be looking at the work of the artist Jim Dine. He's a 1960s artist as part of our observational drawing skills. We're going to try and break down some of the worries that people have about making very, very technical drawings. We're going to really simplify that down but make some really good, strong drawings.
Before we start the workshop activity, let's first look at some of Jim Dine's work. And let's find some of his history out as well, which is really interesting. Jim Dine was born in America in Ohio in 1935. At a time between the First World War and the Second World War, and a period in American history that was known as the Great Depression. And it was a time when people didn't have much money. Because of that, he spent a lot of time at his grandparents' hardware store, where he would have been surrounded by cans of paint, tools, garden implements, and strangely enough, some of these items became part of his work in later life. In the 1960s, Jim Dine was linked with the pop art movement, and these were a group of artists who looked at common everyday objects that you were finding in American culture at the time. They rejected all the old paintings of the past and were more interested in the new youth sort of things that were happening in America at the time. So you regularly see things like Coca-Cola bottles, soup tins, pictures from comic books. Here are three examples of pop art. The first one, Andy Warhol, again looking at cultural things. He went into supermarkets and found soup cans, brought them back into his studio and made gigantic screen prints of them. Again, with the emphasis on the artwork and the branding on the labels themselves. Roy Lichtenstein, he went out and looked at comics, throwaway comics that would be everywhere out on the streets, brought them back and enlarged them so you could actually see every tiny printing dot on them. Klaus Oldenburg took a different approach. He actually made three-dimensional sculptures, but they were soft, so inside there would have been soft materials in them. And these would have been exhibited in museums and art galleries, which allow people to go up to them and press them and feel how soft these objects were. Here now are two examples of Jim Dine's work, again looking at the tools that he often used in his work. Again, you may ask, why are you using these? But these are, again, everyday objects, just like the soup cans, just like the comics, things that would have been thrown away. And I think Jim Dine's idea was to bring some sort of sense of importance to these things that would often be overlooked and once they'd served a use would be thrown away into the bin. Like all artists, Jim Dine experimented with different materials, and over the years he's worked with different things, different materials and techniques. So one of the images, he's used spray cans to create a background that's faded. He's used pastels and chalks, oil paintings. Again, always experimenting, pushing the boundaries and looking for the colour. As you can see, around most of the items, he always creates a dark outline to bring some sort of emphasis to these objects. Jim Dine has always been an obsessive artist, and again, as well as painting tools over and over again, different kind of tools from saws, chisels, hammers, he's also looked at hearts. And one of his, if you ever Google him, you'll find that most of his artwork comes up and that you'll see this motif that appears time and time again, and that is of the heart. Later on, he looked at things like everyday objects like dressing gowns, and he's painted these in so many different times and different colours and different ways. And again, something like a dressing gown would have a certain life, but what Jim Dine has done is decided to create it so something of permanence. Our key words today to look at before we start the work and even reflecting back on it are things that we're considering are observational drawing. So what we want you to be doing is just drawing only what you see. So what you could be doing from home is selecting a tool, something that you might find in the shed or garage or a drawer. It can be any sort of item. It might be a pair of scissors, a spoon, a fork. Okay, what we want you to do is place it on the paper and then try to think about the negative space that's actually on the outside edge of the object itself. Try to include some details and pattern in the object to make it more interesting. The again, going off the grades, this is something that Kerry and I have said to you, to try to bring this in and bring it as part of the strength into your work, because it will give you a much, much better grade. Begin by using faint construction lines. It's really important, just draw around the outline of something with a very, very thin pencil to give you that basic lines. Again, if you make a mistake, it's something that you can rub out and start again. Try to add some tone. Tone is the difference between light and dark, okay? So we're looking at the highlights, so the very brightest parts of an object, and then the shadows. So obviously, as Jim Dine does, the shadows are right around the edges, and these really emphasise and bring it off the paper itself. When that is completed, we want you to add some extra tools. Again, just keep investigating. What we want you to do is to put different objects of different sizes next to each other to show difference between scale and depth.